Hi everyone, and welcome to the Finbox Academy. In this lesson, you will learn how to analyze a balance sheet with 10 ratios that will help you assess the financial health of a company. Before we start, let's review what the goals of a balance sheet analysis are. A sound balance sheet analysis should help you answer these questions. Does the company have the necessary liquidity to pay its current debts? That is liquidity analysis. Can the company handle its long-term debts with ease? That is solvency analysis. Is the company using its assets efficiently? Efficiency analysis. Let's start with liquidity analysis. If the company's liquidity is not good enough, it could face severe difficulties in paying its current debts and daily expenses if its daily income stops, as in the case of a pandemic. The consequences would be even more severe in the event of a credit crunch, i.e. a sudden reduction in the general availability of loans. The following balance sheet ratios will help you assess if a company's liquidity is good enough. The current ratio is probably the most used liquidity ratio. It is equal to current assets divided by current liabilities. Investors and analysts utilize it to assess whether the company has enough current assets to pay off its short-term debt. A ratio below 1 is a warning sign, because it could indicate that the company is facing financial difficulties. However, this varies from sector to sector, and the best way to check the company is in the safe zone is to compare it to the other companies in the sector. The easiest way to do that is with the Finbox Data Explorer. Just search for the metric you want, in this case the current ratio, then scroll down to the sector benchmark analysis and check in which percentile is your stock. If it is in the lowest one, such as under the 20% percentile, you may want to dig deeper into the company's liquidity. Okay, let's move on to the quick ratio. The quick ratio is equal to current assets minus inventories divided by current liabilities. It tells you if a company has enough liquid assets to pay off its short-term debt. The quick ratio is more conservative than the current ratio. It is preferable for all the industries with a high DIO, or days inventory outstanding. The DIO is a metric that indicates how rapidly a firm sells the inventory it has in stock. For all the industries with a high DIO, it's better to exclude inventories from the calculation because they are not necessarily easily convertible into cash. You can find out if your company has an adequate quick ratio by comparing it to other companies in the industry with the same process used previously. The defensive internal ratio is equal to current assets divided by daily cash expenditures, that is, EBIT divided by the number of days in a year. The defensive internal ratio, or DIR, indicates how many days the company can pay its daily cash expenses without other funding than its current assets. This is one of the best balance sheet ratios for liquidity analysis, because it provides the analyst with the exact number of days the firm can operate without seeking external funding. Okay, now you know how to analyze a balance sheet to check if a company has enough liquidity. Let's move on to solvency analysis. Solvency analysis helps you evaluate the ability of a company to pay its long-term debt and the interest on that debt. A financially strong company has enough liquidity to pay its short-term obligations and at the same time must manage its capital structure appropriately. Let's find out how to analyze a balance sheet with solvency ratios. The first metric on the list is the equity multiplier. It is equal to total assets divided by equity. It is a financial leverage ratio that measures the portion of assets that are financed by equity. An equity multiplier ratio that is too high compared to other companies in the industry may indicate that management is being too aggressive in running the business. It is common knowledge that high leverage is a bad thing. However, you'll be surprised to learn that according to James O'Shaughnessy's research, high financial leverage doesn't necessarily mean that the stock will perform poorly. In his studies, he considers the entire US stock market and divides the stocks into 10 deciles according to their financial leverage. Stocks in the lowest decile, those with the lowest financial leverage, performed much worse than those in the highest decile, those with the highest financial leverage. It seems that the market punishes stocks that are managed too conservatively, because low financial leverage can lead to low returns. What's more, the equity multiplier alone can't tell you much about the business. A company with high financial leverage may be safer than a company with a lower one if it generates much more cash flow to cover that debt. Not surprisingly, the same research demonstrates that companies with low cash flow to total debt drastically underperform the market. In the 45-year backtest period between 1964 and 2009, stocks in the lowest decile for cash flow to total debt generated a 2.41% compounded annual return compared to the 11.22% compounded annual return of the overall market. If you don't want to underperform the market, you should definitely check in which decile your stocks are. You can check that with the Finbox Data Explorer, with the same process we used for the current ratio. Another financial leverage ratio that tells you how the company is financing its growth is the long-term debt to equity. It is equal to long-term debt divided by shareholders' equity. The same considerations made before also apply to this ratio. High debt doesn't necessarily mean bad performance. You must consider all the other factors related to debt. What sector does the company operate in? Does the company generate enough cash flow to cover that debt? What is the company using that debt for? An easy way to evaluate a company's financial strength is to compare it to its sector. As of June 2020, the sectors with the highest debt-to-equity ratio are utilities, real estate, and consumer discretionary. You can have up-to-date stats and graphs like that directly in Excel or in Google Spreadsheets with the Finbox Excel add-in. To download it for free, go to finbox.com/integrations/Excel. Last but not least, efficiency ratios help you evaluate how well a company manages its assets. An efficient business can make the difference between a stock that underperforms the market and one that outperforms it. One of the best known efficiency ratios is asset turnover. It is equal to revenue divided by average total assets. This ratio is typically used to measure how efficiently a company is using its assets to generate revenue. A higher asset turnover ratio indicates a more efficient business that is generating more revenue for every dollar of assets. According to research carried out by James O'Shaughnessy, in the 45-year backtest period between 1964 and 2009, stocks in the lowest decile for asset turnover generated a 7.64% compounded annual return compared to the 11.22% of the whole market. At the same time, stocks in the highest decile, those with a high asset turnover ratio, generated a 13% compounded annual return, beating the market. You can find the stocks with the highest asset turnover ratio using the Finbox Stock Screener. It covers more than 100,000 stocks worldwide and supports more than 1,000 metrics. What's more, you can also create custom metrics after exporting the results to Excel. The best part? You can use it for free forever. Another efficiency ratio is days inventory outstanding. It is equal to the number of days in a year multiplied by average inventory divided by cost of goods sold. It measures the average number of days a company takes to turn its inventory in sales. It tells you how well a company manages its inventory. Days sales outstanding is equal to the number of days in a year multiplied by average account receivables divided by credit sale. It tells you the average number of days it takes for a company to collect cash from sales made on credit. How many times do you hear the expression, cash is king? Well, this is exactly the case. Since a company cannot use the credit it holds to pay its expenses and invest in the business, it must collect the cash as quickly as possible. Days payables outstanding is equal to the number of days in a year multiplied by account payables divided by the cost of goods sold. It measures the average number of days it takes for a company to pay its suppliers. In this case, it is the opposite of what we said before. A higher ratio gives the company much more flexibility in managing the business. At the same time, a too high ratio could be a warning sign that the company has some difficulty in paying its suppliers. The cash conversion cycle is equal to DIO plus DSO minus DPO. Although it may seem a bit difficult at first, the cash conversion cycle is a very simple concept. It simply tells you how much time passes between the time the company uses cash to pay suppliers and the time it receives cash from its customers. A lower cash conversion cycle is better, since it means the company is collecting cash quickly from its customers and at the same time has more flexibility in paying its suppliers. Before you leave, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, because in the following days, we'll publish new videos with a lot of stats like the one you saw in this one that will help you improve your investment performance. See you at the next lesson.